to reduce the clutter on your table, you need a direction. So something like PrepLadder gives us that direction. You have some 40 hours or 50 hours of
I have given all the content of pharmacology.
I have contributed the entire content for internal medicine.
I have created the content for PSM.
You can trust the questions and explanations to be genuine.
Detailed explanations will help you solve the different variations of the same question.
Textbook references will help you authenticate an answer.
I have created this content after close inspection of the previous year questions.
I have put in my 14 years of experience into creating these questions.
Includes the latest exam questions, questions on the recent updates, as well as the image-based questions.
All questions are according to recent exam trends and difficulty level.
So the software would be exactly like the real exam.
All your queries come directly to me.
So if you have any kind of doubt, you can ask me directly.
I'll be solving all your microbiology related queries.
You can ask anything about the subject, doesn't have to be only about a question.
I'm always available for you whenever you need help.
You can have a counseling session with me.
So we've put in features to make sure you keep studying. The PrepLadder app will never let you fall behind.
Solving obs and gynec questions will be easy for you after this.
You would not have to worry about anatomy at all.
You'll be able to solve most of the questions in PSM.
Most pathology questions in the exams are going to be derivatives or the repeats from these questions.
1 lakh competitors.
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 It's good to see that everyone in the team is giving their best.
This is the best team of faculties that could have been put together.
This is the biggest innovation in medical education.
We are obsessed with making sure that you get the best value out of every minute spent on the PrepLadder app.
Really happy to be a part of Team PrepLadder.
You know, if there was something like PrepLadder when I was preparing, I'm sure that I would have prepared much better because I would have known what to read.
Hypoparathyroidism. The values of PTH here would be down and reduced, so we need to see what is the reason behind it. One of the leading reasons for development of hypoparathyroidism in a patient is autoimmunity. Following autoimmunity, the second most important reason of why you would be having this kind of a situation could be thyroid surgery. You see, during thyroid surgery, like for example, if a total thyroidectomy is being done in the patient, then there's a possibility that there might be an inadvertent parathyroid resection in the patient. And this inadvertent parathyroid resection, will result in development of a hypoparathyroidism in a patient. The third cause for this could be Dijon syndrome. This disease is related to chromosome number 22, and the manifestations in the patient would be that in Dijon syndrome, the thymus gland of the patient and the parathyroid gland of the patient both are exhibiting a hypoplasia. So because there is a hypoplasia of the thymus gland of the patient, the cell-mediated immunity of the patient is on the lower side, which will explain the recurrent infections like pneumonia seen in the patient. And because there is a parathyroid gland hypoplasia in a patient, the value of PTH in the body of the patient will be reduced, and the low value of PTH in the body would mean that the values of calcium in the body of this patient will also become less. So there are two reasons why Dijon syndrome is asked. One is for the immunity part and second for deficiency of calcium. This deficiency of calcium will cause rickets-like illness in the patient. I repeat again, this is not nutritional rickets, it is rickets like illness in the patient. So I'm highlighting the fact that this person will have features like rickets, like wide open anterior fontanelle or delayed dentition, etc. could be features that are given in Dijon syndrome. A combination of the two is the syndrome itself, which is chromosome 22 defect. Now, once we know the causes, we are now understanding that once PTH in the body becomes lesser, the values of serum calcium in the blood of the patient, ionized calcium in the blood of the patient will also be lesser. If you have less PTH and less calcium, the impact on the patient will be either we could have acute manifestations or we could be having is chronic manifestations. So I will be first handling the acute manifestations and then we will talk about the chronic. For acute one, I can say the clinical situation can be that a patient of yours underwent a thyroid surgery. And after undergoing a thyroid surgery, after 72 hours, because in thyroid surgery, the surgeon inadvertently removed the parathyroid gland also. So after 72 hours in this patient, there is a possibility that there would be a development of features of tetany. Since PTH values have been falling, the serum calcium of this patient will also begin to fall. Now, because in the patient, the serum calcium is beginning to reduce, what will happen will be, tetany, remember, is seen when serum calcium is less than 7. So when the serum calcium of the patient will begin to fall, ionized calcium will also begin to fall. That is when the person will start complaining of perioral and periungual paresthesias. There would be tingling sensation around the lips and tingling sensation around the fingertips of the patient. So perioral and periungual paresthesias could be present in this patient. In this particular patient with perioral and periungual paresthesias, you will apply a BP cuff in the arm of the patient. This BP cuff will be deployed by you to demonstrate the presentation of trosseus sign, where you deploy the BP cuff in the arm of the patient and inflate it to 20 mm above systolic blood pressure, there will be triggering of carpopedal spasm. This carpopedal spasm is also known as obstetrician's hand because of the peculiar position of the thumb of the patient, that would be adductor spasm. You will then tap on the anterior border of the parotid gland of the patient to elicit Chuvostok sign. Chuvostok sign, there would be clenching of the muscles of one side of the face of the patient. This is tap on the anterior border of the parotid gland. Tapping on the anterior border of the parotid would result in contraction of the muscles of one side of the face. This will result in an appearance as if the patient is in a lot of pain or discomfort and would be called as facial grimace. In these patients, we are worried because the patient will start developing stridor. This patient can die because of laryngospasm. For these patients, the immediate management would be to provide to the patient IV calcium gluconate. So post thyroid surgery, if a patient is having manifestations discussed here, calcium gluconate should be given. But this is not a permanent solution. The drug of choice for surgically induced hypoparathyroidism. SX would mean surgical induced hypoparathyroidism. We will have to give injections of teriparatide to the patient. Teriparatide has been approved for management of patients who are having surgically induced hypoparathyroidism. Not routine cases, but surgically induced hypoparathyroidism, teriparatide is definitely indicated. So we can manage the acute manifestations pretty comfortably if we go in for early identification. But if a patient is having chronic hypocalcemia, then the manifestations are a little difficult to identify from nutritional rickets. So let us see what are the clinical features that are noticed by you in any patient having a chronic hypocalcemia. Here the PTH is reduced in the patient, so the features of the patients would be that of rickets-like illness. The features of the patients will be that of rickets-like illness. I'm using the word rickets like illness in the patient to highlight that this is definitely not nutritional rickets. One of the early features that will be encountered in these patients would be that of ping pong skull, that is craniotapes. Craniotapes would imply that the skull of the patient will be very soft and can be easily deformable. The second feature will be usually seen after 6 months, that there would be widening of the wrist joint of the patient because of the soft bones, because of the distal end of the radius having insufficient calcium deposition, there would be, or because of pressure, widening of the wrist joint of the patient, the distal end of the radius is splayed. in these patients, the leg muscles will also be, the bones of the legs will also be relatively short. These patients will tend to have a disproportionate short stature. What you imply by the word disproportionate short stature is that the legs of the patient, especially the femur and the tibia, would be relatively short. There will also be a wide open anterior fontanelle. In the mouth of the baby of 1.5 years of age, there will be no teeth. Delayed dentition is defined as no teeth in a baby beyond the age of 13 months. So beyond a wide open anterior fontanelle, there would be a delayed dentition developing in a patient. Subsequently, in these patients, you could be having skeletal abnormalities. Now, one of the skeletal abnormalities that could be encountered or seen in these patients could be that the patient could be having is knock knees. Another possibility can be that these patients could be having is development of bow legs, B-O-W, bow legs. And another possibility can be that the patient can be having on one leg, the patient could be having a knock knee, contralateral side, there would be a bow leg. In one side, there would be a valgum, and other side, there would be a varum in a patient. The third one that I've drawn, this is known as wind swept deformity. This would be genu varum, and this would be genu valgum in a patient. So genu valgum, genu varum, and wind swept deformity. These are the three bony deformities that can be encountered in patients with rickets-like illness. Now I want you to pay special attention to part number 7 of this discussion, and I want to highlight the fact that 1 to 6 can be seen in nutritional rickets also, but for part number 7 I would like to say that these patients would be having a short 4th and the 3rd metacarpal bone. Now what is the significance of it? The significance is that if you make a fist like this, you and me can see the knuckles. We can see the knuckles here, like 4 knuckles can be seen. In these patients, the 3rd and the 4th metacarpal bones are shorter. So because the 3rd and the 4th metacarpal bones are shorter, these bones are metacarpal bones are shorter, you would not see a knuckle here. You would rather see a dimple here. So you would get a knuckle, knuckle, dimple, dimple sign here. Looks funny. Knuckle, knuckle, dimple, dimple sign. This knuckle, knuckle, dimple, dimple sign is also known as Archibald sign. I'll repeat the data again. One of the clinical features that is encountered in patients who are having rickets like illness due to PTH deficiency is known as Archibald sign. In Archibald sign, when you make the fist in the hand of the child, you will be able to feel the initial 2 knuckles, but you will not be able to feel the subsequent 2 knuckles because of the fact that the metacarpal bones are shorter. There is a short 3rd and a 4th. This is 3rd and a 4th metacarpal bone. So the manifestation that we have just discussed, that is short and third and fourth metacarpals, this is known as Archibald sign, or is also known as knuckle knuckle dimple dimple sign. This feature will help you in differentiating the particular patient from a patient who is having nutritional rickets, and all these features that I have mentioned here before you of chronic hypocalcemia, that is rickets like illness in a patient, are technically known as Albright hereditary osteodystrophy. So AHO, that is Albright hereditary osteodystrophy, this is a term that is used to explain the fact that this patient will definitely be having bone changes due to the fact that there is a deficiency of calcium. They might even mimic features of vitamin D, but then you can easily differentiate this from traditional nutritional rickets because we don't have part number 7 discussed. So AHO, Albright hereditary osteodystrophy, is a feature of hypoparathyroidism in a patient. And when I have to work up this patient, obviously because I need to differentiate this person from this patient, from that of traditional rickets. So let's look at the workup of this guy. When I do the blood work of this patient, I will notice that this is not a standard case of nutritional rickets, because in a standard case of nutritional rickets, you will always notice that the SAP values would be elevated. But in this patient, you will notice that the SAP values would be normal. Calcium would be less, phosphate would be increased in the patient. Calcium and phosphate always go the other way, so that's okay. But SAP values would be normal in this patient. That will alert you to the fact that this is unlikely to be nutritional rickets. Then, When you will check the serum PTH assay of the patient, you will notice that in this patient, the serum PTH values will be down in the dumps. The values will be tremendously low. Initially, it might look like a laboratory error, but then SAP is normal in the patient, PTH is less. So you are thinking in terms of damage to the parathyroid gland. Though we don't need to do this next scan, that is a technetium 99 scan, I want to say the fact that if on a technetium 99 scan, that is a system AB scan in a patient, if you have a decreased uptake, it means the fact that the gland is destroyed due to autoimmunity. But if you have an absent uptake, that means it could have been surgically removed also. And in patients who are having Dijon syndrome, there could be a possibility that there is a parathyroid hypoplasia, so there could be decreased uptake. So decrease to absent uptake indicates the fact that the problem starts from the gland of the patient. For management of these patients, obviously supplemental treatment would be given. Calcium supplements are obviously required for the patient. Vitamin D supplementations are required for the patient. But there is no drug of choice for management of hypoparathyroidism in a patient. Teriparatide is not FDA approved for hypoparathyroidism. It is FDA approved for surgically induced hypoparathyroidism, but not for traditional hypoparathyroidism, which could be response, which is secondary to either, I would say, autoimmunity or secondary to presentation of Dijon syndrome that could be presenting since birth.